Okay, let's do this. Jog 3 miles before breakfast. Make it to work by 9. Run out for a salad at lunch. Oh, time to own that meeting at 3. Yes, 10,000 steps. What's next?
Fearless is not hitting snooze. That's the power of the Blue Cross and Blue Shield Federal Employee Program. With more healthy benefits and tools, no one does more to help you live fearless. Sign up at fepblue.org/action by December 14th.
Blog Talk Radio.
Paranormal Review Radio.
Everyone, it is Friday night, and you're listening to Paranormal Review Radio, the only radio show without commercials and with more great paranormal talk. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm Anthony Agati in New York.
And I'm Lucy Liebfried in Chicago. You're listening to one of the highest-rated paranormal radio shows on Blog Talk. No bull, no lies, just a true platform for everyone to share their knowledge and experiences when searching for the truth. Good communication is key. Our phone lines are open for questions or stories. The number to call in is 661-244-9831. Make sure you press the number 1 to get into the queue. We'll try to get to you as soon as we can. Otherwise, the chat room is open so you can post any comments or questions there as well. Don't forget to like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel at Paranormal Review Radio. You'll find more articles, blogs, and full show uploads. And if you have specific questions, comments, or would like to be a guest on the show, email us at paranormal.review@aol.com. Now, sit back, get comfy, and prepare to open your minds. It's time for Paranormal Review Radio.
All right, boys and girls and ghosts and demons. In September of 2011, Lucy and I decided to make a big change in the way that we researched and investigated the paranormal. We'd been surrounded by people, and at that time we were surrounded by a few people who not only used the paranormal to have fun and play games, but you know what, didn't even care about finding the truth or becoming serious. So we decided to remove ourselves from that paranormal group. But in doing so, we felt that we wanted to align with folks who truly took the paranormal seriously and wanted to find answers just as much as we did. We thought there was no better way to do that than to open ourselves up to anyone who would listen and begin a little online radio show called Paranormal Review Radio, bringing people together who had similar thoughts or similar ambitions within the paranormal was way more important than creating a team and wearing black t-shirts. That's when Paranormal Review Radio was born. Being able to bring amazing, talented, intellectual, stimulating guests like Maria D. Jones, Laura Eisenhower, Amy Allen and Steve DeShavi, David Weatherly, Jeff Mudgett, Aaron Sagers, Mike Barra, Brian Kalick, Robert Murch, Patrick Doyle, the guys from Deep South Paranormal, Bill Burns, Mark and Debbie Constantino, Ben Hansen, Nick Groff, Stanton Friedman, Corvus Nocturnum, Michael J. Baker, Karen Dahlman, Paul Burley, Frank Mara and Maria Abate, Kai Blackwood, Nick Redfern, Deanna Kelly Syed, E.A. Coetting, Artie Sixkiller Clark, and Stacey Graham, just to name a few. But the most important guest we have ever had on this show is you, our listeners. We have done this for you and by you. This show would not be what it is without the love, support, interest, interaction, and constant feedback. Whether we are awesome on one show, but not on our mark or on the next, we still try to provide the best and most stimulating platform for everyone to explore and dissect the paranormal in order to answer some of your most compelling questions about life after death and beyond. We thank you for your continued support and hope you stick around with us for many more years to come. There is much more that we want to discuss, what we need to discuss, so the party is not over yet. It has only just begun. And I also want to just add right now a big thank you to my cohort and partner in crime, Lucy Liebfried, for being with me, sticking with me, putting up with my nonsense for the past 4 years and helping to put on what I think is a much more compelling show than I have ever listened to on any other internet radio or AM radio station that's out there right now. I may be biased, but that's me.
You know what? This show has been, and I've said this before, and I'm going to say it again, it has been a labor of love. We're not, you know, when we first started doing this, it wasn't to become famous or to make a name or anything like that. It really was to be able to connect with other people who thought the same, who were looking for answers, and it has turned out to be probably one of the most fun things I've ever done. I mean, I just adore every Friday night. I'm so glad that me and you decided to do this. I can't wait to see where it goes. I mean, I never, you know, who thought we would still be here 4 years later, you know? I mean, this is just like, this to me is amazing. Every Friday night that we do this, and the people that listen, and the people that we talk to, I mean, it just freaking amazes me every week. And I enjoy listening to it, even though we're part of it.
Well, you know, we may not be the best, you know, and I don't know what the best is. You know, people talk about, you know, this is the best paranormal, this is the best paranormal show. I don't know what the best is. You know, obviously because I'm on the air, it is, you know, up to you guys who are listening to decide what is the best. But I think that, you know, in comparison to a lot of other shows, and I don't want to do this, but in comparison to other shows, we're not a cookie-cutter type of operation. Yes, we do have a list of questions that we like to ask our guests. You know, we want to make sure that it is professional, somewhat professional, but at least we have something on hand that we have that we're ready to go with. But that's only a starting point. That's only a jumping-off point that we use our, you know, pre-written questions out on. If you've noticed a lot of the shows that we have, you know, typically you'll hear us right off the cuff ask a lot of questions because it all depends upon what the guest is talking about. And sometimes we go off in tangents. There's been a bunch of shows, if I remember correctly, where I don't even think we used our pre-written questions at all. It was basically completely off the cuff. It may sound horrible, but, you know, we're trying to think and talk at the same time. It's not that easy. So, you know, to me, I think, though, that we try and ask the more compelling questions. We don't, you know, pretty much stay safe. Yes, we do stay safe, but we do go off, and we know how to professionally and respectfully ask questions to get the answers that we're looking for or to see if we can poke people that we have on as a guest to try and see, you know, how far we could go or if there's another area that we could tackle, maybe let's try that. You know, I've listened to a lot of other shows where they talk about the main points, you know, what did you do, how did you do that, and what's the book about or what's the show about, and a lot of them talk about their personal stuff, like the hosts talk about their personal stuff to the guests. I personally don't like to do that because I know then the guest gets frustrated. They feel as though they're not even a guest. They're just listening to the host. But we try not to do that because I'm picking their brain. I have a certain amount of time, and Lucy has a certain amount of time that we have with these guests that we want to get as much information as we can from them. So we try and ask the questions that a lot of people either have not asked, or we go a little bit further than what other people have asked these same guests before on other shows. We try and go just a little bit further just to see if it opens up another door or another window that we can actually explore and learn from. So, you know, it is a labor of love, this show. We both, Lucy and I, both have day jobs. You know, we don't sit around at home and constantly do this show, which I wish we could do, but we don't. We have day jobs, and so there are many nights, many sleepless nights, many crazy nights where we're running home from work, either trying to get on the air or trying to get the research or contact guests or get things lined up for weeks and months ahead of time. So it is work. It is a lot of work, but we love to do it. And the reason why we love to do it is not just because of the particular guests that we have on, but we get to sit every Friday night and see folks come into the chat room and talk amongst themselves or interact with us either on air or off air, you know, on our Facebook page or personal emails, whatever it may be. We love that. Love, love, love that. It is the most exciting thing to me than the actual show itself, is knowing that the people out there in airwave land are listening to us and are thinking about the things that we're talking about and maybe debating some of the things. You know, we don't say everything that's correct. And so if there's a different solution or a different answer to what we're proposing or what our guest is proposing, we love those comments and feedback from people because it actually has turned my mind around several times. I know that for sure. I can admit that. But this is an amazing atmosphere. It's an amazing world that Lucy and I are in, and we are so glad that you guys, all of you guys, are a part of it. Because I don't know, I can't imagine a Friday night not doing this at all. I don't know. I know last Friday I was not here and I had withdrawal symptoms. I was just, you know, I was you know, shaking and whatever. It is my life, and you guys are a part of it. So thank you all for being by our sides for the last 4 years and, you know, enjoying the paranormal and learning about the paranormal together with us, because we're learning just as much as you are.
Yeah, I mean, really, I mean, this is, we're students. We're not experts, and we've always said that. We're not experts. And, God, I would never claim to be an expert about anything. We're students of the paranormal, and every single one of these guests have always given us something that we can either add to our knowledge database. And that's one thing I do want to mention. I mean, like the guests that we have. I like to think that we're kind of different, that we don't, you know, I've heard a lot of shows, you know, where they talk to like teams and groups and stuff. And, you know, that's nice, you know, and I'm sure there's a niche for that. But for us, I want to talk to the people that I think that you guys out there would like to talk to, you know, to the people that are writing the books and doing research, just like we are, just like everybody else is, the people that are actually really finding something different, you know, I mean, because you can turn, you can go online anytime and you can find so many different shows and, you know, not to, and I don't want to knock anybody down, but sometimes they all seem to be a little bit the same. So what I would like to do, especially when I'm looking at guests, is to try to find something different, somebody that we haven't heard from, somebody that really has something different and interesting, maybe a new theory, maybe a new idea, something that is really going to change the way you think. And like Anthony said, it has happened quite a bit. I mean, you know, there are times when there's been a topic and I really thought I thought this way about it. And then after listening to our guests, I'm like, you know, maybe there is a difference. You know, there's something else. So I'm just happy that we're here, and I'm just so happy that every single one of you are there. And thank you so much, guys. Thank you.
You know, I'm actually curious if anybody's in chat and listening. I know some people are having a hard time getting audio right now from the show, and I apologize. I have no control over that, and Lucy has no control over that. It's this damn blog talk radio that just acts up sometimes. So just keep trying refreshing. I know you probably can't even hear me, but, you know, if you have those problems, typically just refresh or try a different type of internet browser. That sometimes helps as well. But I'm curious for those that are in the chat room right now, like Angela and Kai and Katie and Mary Magdalene. Hello. Haven't seen you in a while. Thank you for joining us. Sharon Swift. I'm curious to know if there's any show that we've had in the past that maybe you were thinking one way and either the guest or the conversation that we had steered you in a different direction or made you think differently about some paranormal topic that we were discussing at that moment. I'm curious to know if anybody in chat right now, I'd love to see if there's anybody that can type in and say it. If not, then great. You know, maybe we're all on the same plane and we've got the same minds. So that's good in my opinion. But I'm curious about that just to see, you know, how people think, how their minds work, and if things are shifting or if things are changing. I don't know. So if you guys have any stories like that, you know, I'd love to read it in chat, and I'll conversate with you guys back and forth on that. Or if you'd like to call in, be my guest at 661-244-9831. You guys are all welcome to join us tonight on the air. We've got a couple of surprise guests that are going to be calling in tonight from our past shows, and they promised to call in. I think we have one that's going to be calling in at about 30 minutes or so, and then another caller will be on the air with us maybe about 45, 50 minutes from now. So we'll be talking directly with those two folks, which I'm not going to say. It's going to be a surprise. And we have also a bunch of audio clips from our previous shows that just within this past year that we sort of just wanted to go through and review a little bit, just a year in review type of thing, of some of the guests that we've had in the last 12 months. And believe it or not, we've had 46 shows in the last 12 months. And if my computer gets up correctly, I'm going to tell you, Lucy, do you know how many shows we've had in all 4 years?
No, I should have looked at it, and of course I didn't.
This show tonight will be our 203rd episode.
203
wow. Episodes of The Paranormal. So congratulations to everybody on that accomplishment, because it's not just us doing it. So we've got some audio clips that we're going to talk about and then, you know, interject in between there. Who knows where the show is going to go tonight? It's celebratory, so if you've got alcohol around, drink it. If you've got anything else, do it. Whatever you want to do, have fun tonight, because we're going to go down memory lane and talk about you guys and talk about the show.
One thing I do have to say before I forget about it. Last week's show, you weren't there. And I still do not like doing the show by myself. I know I can do it by myself. It just doesn't feel right if you're not there. Because then I kind of have to be like a little bit more serious than I usually am. And you're the serious one. You're the one that has the feet on the ground. I'm fluff. So I really did miss you when you weren't there. And I don't like doing the show without you. So there. Okay?
I noticed in chat, Kai had written that we introduced her to The Afterlife of Billy Fingers. And she wrote that that book was so soul-warming for her. Well, thank you, and I'm glad that we were able to introduce. That was an interesting show that we did about Billy Fingers and her son and everything. And so it was, it had been at that moment in time one of the, I think it was the most highest rated or highest selling books on the market at that point. And I think maybe still could be within that rank. you know, everywhere I go, I always hear and see things about Billy Fingers, and she's always posting on her Facebook page a lot of quotes and inspiring quotes and soul-warming quotes, as Kai had mentioned. There's a lot of good that's coming from her, and her journey has led her in a direction, from what I believe, is something that she can keep dear to her heart and her soul, and keep personal, because it is a you know, it is a family experience for her, and that's the way that she was able to cope with the misgivings that happened in her life. So, you know, I can't take the credit, and Lucy, I don't think can take the credit. I think it's Billy Fingers that was credited KO, which I think I just said correctly, KO.
Now you said it right.
to enrich and give her a soul-warming experience. So that's great. Great. I'm happy for
and
that.
It actually is her brother. It's her brother that passed.
Oh, her brother.
And,
sorry, yeah.
Yeah, and then her brother started communicating with her afterwards, after his,
right.
his passing. So
right.
just wanted to make that little correction there. But
all right, so do you want to get into some of the clips that we have and talk about that, or is
yeah.
there anything else that you want to start off with?
Well, we have some updates from some of our guests from the past
oh.
year. And actually, the first update that I have, we do have a clip that goes with it if you want to do that. First clip that the first update, because we did reach out to some the guests from the past year. And, of course, you know, people got things going, so they sent us little updates. And the first one that we did get, and you know what, I really, really love this guy. He is all, you know, he's become a friend, really. And it was from Kai Blackwood. And he was on the show back, it was October 24th, 2014, almost a whole year ago. And the show was Sold My Soul to Satan. And it was the True Devil documentary. And Kai sent us the following. He says, sorry for the delayed response. It's been a really busy month. I'd love to call in, but I'm scheduled to be in the editing room on Friday night tonight. And he's putting together a teaser trailer for an upcoming feature and racing the clock to get it finished. He wishes us a happy, happy 4th anniversary to us and the show. And he can't thank us enough for bringing him into the Paranormal Review family. Much love from Kai. So, I really, really did enjoy this show. I did. And I wasn't sure where it was going to go. I really had no idea. But after talking to him, he's just so cool. He really is.
Not only cool, but he is truly an honest and real, and I he may not admit it, but he's an insightful person. He on that show when we're talking about the documentary that he did when he's supposedly had sold his soul to the devil and doing that huge ritual, which anybody can watch. It's called Sold My Soul to Satan. If you go to YouTube, you can probably find it on YouTube, but it may be on other websites as well. And you can watch, I think it's about an hour long, and it shows his journey going, starting this whole thing, learning about the ritual, gathering all of the materials for the actual ritual, and then you get to see, bits and pieces of the actual ritual being done to him on that night. And then there's at the end of the film, there's a follow-up. It's a one-year later follow-up to him and how he talks about how his life has been. But on our show that we had last October of 2014, he had talked to us about some of the issues that he had after doing the ritual, which wasn't fully completed, and he admitted that to us. And you can see that as well on the actual video of the ritual. So it wasn't truly, truly completed, and so he thought since it wasn't truly completed, that nothing had happened. But he did go through a stint of really bad—I wouldn't even say bad luck—but he had a rough, rough period of time where just everything was falling to pieces. and fell apart. And so we got really heavy and deep with him. And at one point, there was a what I called a psychiatry session with him, where he was just so down on himself, I remember, and just thinking that, he had that Christian guilt in him, that Catholic guilt, that, he was deserving of all of the bad because of how he led his life and what he did in that ritual. And so he felt as though there was no way to turn it around. And Lucy and I kept telling him, well, you got to think positive. And he did. And, his life did turn around, I think, in a positive direction. You know, he got married. He had another daughter. And now he's doing films again. So kudos to him and congratulations to him. But I did want to just play the clip that we had from that night. And he talks about, in this clip, Kai talks about why he crushed up the mirror, the black mirror that he took from that ritual. There is one piece of in the film where the black mirror is beside him, and during the ritual, the mirror cracks. And once that mirror cracks, that meant the ritual could not continue anymore. But after this ritual, Kai took that mirror and took some other items as well back with him and kept it with him in his home. And we thought, and he thought as well, that that was the reason why he was continuing to have this bad luck and just, going downhill. And so he talks about one of the instances when his friend comes over his house. Excuse me. When his friend comes over the house, and this is the point when he realizes that he has to get rid of this mirror and all the other items. And this is what he talks about. Take a listen.
It was wrapped in a towel. I wrapped it in another towel. I took a hammer, and smashed that thing to powder. Literally, it was powder. Nothing but powder, no big chunks, no nothing. And then I poured it all down the toilet and flushed it because I didn't want it in my house anymore, and I'm going to tell you why. I used to have, well, I got rid of that too, but that was a different reason, cats. And this awesome, big, poofy red couch, right? It was the biggest, most comfortable red couch in the whole world. I loved it. In the way that my living room is set up, right behind it was that drawer with all the skulls on it and all the drawers. And I had a friend over who, because I'd been having some weird things happen in the house, like around that time. And she was like, I want to see if any of that happens. And again, I'm not one of those people. I'm not one of those tools. So all this, but some weird stuff was happening, like very bizarre things. So she's sitting at my house in the puffy couch, leaning back in the big puffy pillow on the big puffy couch. And we're talking for, about a half an hour. Like, let's go get something to eat. So we go to get something to eat. She tells me while we're out to eat. She's like, I didn't really feel anything in your house except for sitting on the couch. She's like, I felt very heavy. Very, very heavy. Like, while sitting right there on the couch. Now, she was sitting where I normally sat every single night. Like, while things were deteriorating, I just started to sit and have a glass of wine and wonder what the hell I was going to do with my life kind of thing. However, when we went back to my house, you could still see the indent because it was awesome. Did I mention it was puffy?
Yeah.
Puffy pillow. But it was still there was still an indent from where she was leaning on it. It was directly in front of that drawer, all those drawers where the pact and all the stuff from the ritual was. Right, and that's the only place. And she didn't know that. She had no idea that. I don't even know that she knew about the whole devil thing in the ritual. But she said that was the one place where she felt like an oppressive heaviness, like a thick, I think she said thick, thick heaviness in my house. And after that, I was like, that's it, I knew it. And I just took all that stuff out. I carefully took the mirror pieces out by themselves, threw them all out separately, and that's why I didn't throw the pack in the garbage. That's why I crushed it into tiny, tiny, tiny pieces and flushed it down the toilet, so there's no way that those two things will ever meet. Even in its dust form, it will never meet the mirror. And I think
you're still living in the same house?
Yeah.
Well, I just want to caution people and warn people. I don't recommend crushing anything that you've ever done like that and flushing it down the toilet. Maybe there's another way to remove it, but I wouldn't do it down the toilet.
Yeah, but you know what? what I really like about Kai is that, like you said, he's honest, and he really did want to disassociate himself from everything that he had done. And I think he's done it. I mean, one of the things that I have to mention and that I truly, truly love about this guy, he has a daughter, and that daughter obviously is the apple of his eye. If you see the pictures that he posts of his little girl, she is an absolute angel. And I've never seen anybody who just seems to enjoy being a dad so much as he does. So I want to give him a big shout out, and to his family, his wife and his daughter. And I just wish the best for them. I really do.
You know, we also had Kai back on just this past January talking about the fear of death. And, you know, because when he was on the show originally back in October of last year, he alluded to the fact that he was really interested in the paranormal, but never got into discussions about it, never got into conversations about it. And I think coming on our show sort of opened him up to the idea that, you know, maybe he could do that. Maybe there was that outlet that he could. And so he had, we had discussed after the show about him coming back on to talk about the fear of death, because that was one of the things that he had, which was the reason why he sort of did the pact with Satan, was his fear of death. He did not want to die. He wanted to live forever. And if living forever meant anything, he would want fame and fortune as well. And so that was one of the things that he tried to accomplish. And so we had him back on the show in January of this year to talk about the fear of death. And that was a stimulating conversation. And out of that conversation, he started to talk about aliens and UFOs and his theories that he has about them. Now, I don't know if he actually physically saw anything, but he has thoughts in his head about it. And, you know, he's been very busy. We've been very busy. So we haven't had a chance to get him back on the show. But we will very, very soon get him back on the show and maybe talk about aliens or maybe other types of paranormal stuff. He just has so many things, not that he's an expert on it, but I'd love to hear his thoughts and his theories about it, especially because he's gone through this whole pact with Satan. You know, did any of that change, and did his mindset sort of shift? Because if you heard in that clip just now, he was not into the paranormal. He doesn't believe in those things, but yet he does. Subconsciously, he does. And I find that in a lot of people when they find out that, you know, we do what we do. You know, they always say, that's weird, but then the next breath out of their mouth is, well, you know, I had an experience when I was 10 years old or whatever it is. So everybody's got it. But I think there's got to be an outlet for people, and that's why we were hoping that this show would do for people is create that outlet and that platform for everyone.
I think it has. I mean, a lot of times, you know, you tell people what we do, and yeah, you know, you do get the like, oh, you know, that's weird. But everybody definitely has some kind of opinion. They don't always want to talk about it, or maybe they're not used to talking about it. But then when they find out that we're into it, then all of a sudden it's like the floodgates open and all of this comes out. And then you actually do find out, hey, we do have something in common. There is, you know, people do think about it. So, yeah, I think what we're doing is helping people open up and getting that conversation going, getting that dialogue going. And that's a cool thing. That's a good thing.
All right, so who else did we get updates from?
Ah, okay. Well, the next update that we got was one of my favorite subjects, of course. It was from the show that we did on January 9th, 2015. It was Encounters with Star People, Untold Stories of American Indians. And that is a book that was written by Artie Sixkiller Clark. And she sent us an update, and she said that she's returning to her mountain cabin on Wednesday, and there's no internet or telephone service, so she's not able to call in. But she had a ski accident last November, and she broke 5 bones in her right leg. She's fully recovered, but it gave her time to go through some more notes and tapes. And as a result, she's going to have a new book coming out in early 2016. It'll be more stories from American Indians and their encounters. There's 45 new stories that focus on American Indians that who live both on and off the reservation. She said that I was interested during my research about collecting stories from Indians who did not live on the reservation to see if their stories were different or seemingly impacted by contemporary media. You will have to read the book to find out what I discovered. Thanks for including me, and I do hope that you will invite me on your show in early spring. Yes, we definitely will, Artie. Thank you so much for responding. And, yeah, I mean, this show to me was, well, of course, it's special to me because there's so many things in Native American history that do refer to star people, do refer to UFOs, but they're not. Native American views of UFOs are not as sensational as the rest of the world. It's kind of more accepted. A lot of things in general, spirits, afterlife, all of these things. To the Native American culture, they're all accepted. You know, they're more, we tend to be more accepting of these things. So her book to me was something that really, really, it was interesting. It really got me thinking, you know, I'm not the only one that has these thoughts. And maybe it is because of the culture, or maybe it is because of the way that we're raised, that we have a little bit more accepting of this. I know I have a tendency to just go off on tangents, you know, when I'm talking to people. And I know I get the weird looks, but I really don't care. You know, I mean, it's just the way things are. I mean, I'm accepting of them, and I like to hear what my own culture thinks about it. So this was a really cool thing for me. This was a good show.
I noticed a few more people in the chat room tonight that I do want to announce. I see Pilar Fogel. I think I said that right. Ricky. And our good friend Red Phantom is in chat again with us. Thanks so much, guys, for joining us, and thanks so much, Red, for being there. Oh my God, for what, from the fourth show?
Since the beginning.
And Red, we had just announced just before that this will be our 203rd episode. So you've been with us for a really long time. So we do want to give you a big shout out and a thank you. And promote your show, which is an amazing radio show called The Whatcast. Mm-hmm. So if you guys go on Facebook or just go to Google and type in The Whatcast, you should be able to find their show with Mike. So it is Mike and Mateo. So you'll be amazed at what they put on, and I'm always jealous of Mateo anyway. But the next
person. They're
very big
on Tumblr. You'll find them on Tumblr.
Tumblr, yes.
Yes.
But the next update that we have, which is funny because on Halloween we have revealed that we're going to have a live YouTube show on this doll that was sent to us by one of our listeners named Claire. The doll is called the doll's name is Molly. If I remember right, yes, Molly.
Molly.
And so we're going to have a Halloween show about communicating with this doll. And one of our previous guests that we had on December 5th of last year, the show was titled Haunted Stuff, Demonic Dolls, Screaming Skulls, and Other Creepy Collectibles from the author Stacey Graham, which that to me was an amazing show. We had done another show on haunted dolls before, but it's always good to get a perspective from someone who's really studied this. And Stacey was an amazing guest on the show. And so she wrote to us and she says, "Hey, you two crazy kids, congratulations. This has been a year of transition for me. I'm writing screenplays, including one on Robert the Haunted Doll," which to me, I can't wait. That, I think, is an amazing story. If you guys have not heard or read up on the haunted doll called Robert, please do. It, you know, everybody talks about the Raggedy Ann doll and all, you know, the Conjuring and all this other stuff. Check out Robert the Haunted Doll. You're going to be amazed. So she writes, she's doing a screenplay on Robert the Haunted Doll, and she's shopping a script on a spooky young adult adaptation of Jane Austen's Northanger Abbey. which I know Lucy probably will love. She's also an apprentice agent for Red Sofa Literary, so no books are coming out soon. I'm looking for creepy, talented authors instead. So if you guys are listening and you're an author, and creepy author, to be more specific, go reach out to Stacey Graham. Again, you can probably just Google her name and find her that way. She finishes and she writes, "I'll let you know if any major developments happen. Keep in touch, Stacey." So thank you so much, Stacey, for being a guest on our show. It was an amazing show to learn about, just haunted objects itself. Has always amazed people, I know that. And I haven't fully grasped the concept of how and why souls and spirits would attach themselves to things. I don't think it's any different than buildings and locations, but to be very specific about objects, it still confuses me of that. You know, I understand the lingering aspect of things, but I'm not sure about the idea of actual spirits and souls encompassing some sort of object.
Well, a couple things, like Robert the Doll, just to get back to that. I mean, everyone talks about Annabelle, but Robert's story, he's, to me, is a little bit more intense. I believe he's down in Florida, and he's in a glass case, and there's been reports where before you take a picture of Robert, you really do have to ask him permission. And
right,
there are some more intense things that are going on with there. So I'm really looking forward to her screenplay. And then on the subject of haunted dolls, having something being attached to it, that I'm totally fascinated. And I wanted to ask you, now since you've gotten the doll, that Claire sent to us, have you noticed anything? I mean, have you felt anything, or is she quiet, or what's going on with that? Because she did send us a nice letter that kind of explained some things that were happening to her, which is why she sent it to us. So I'm curious to see, have you felt anything, or has anything kind of happened?
Just to give everybody an update, yes, I did receive the doll last week, and Lucy and I both did a YouTube video, which you can check on our YouTube channel for Paranormal Review Radio. We did an unboxing of this doll, so you guys saw the doll just at the same point that Lucy and I did. And it was a doll that was sent to us by one of our listeners, as I mentioned before, Claire McNulty, and in upstate Pocono Mountain area, New York. And she sent this doll because she had a history of receiving this doll from her grandmother, and her grandmother's sister had, as a child, used to torture this doll and pretend that it was, the grandmother pretended it was her grandmother's sister, which is this woman's grandmother. And it had been in a fire, so there's fire damage. You guys can see what the doll looks like on the video. But on our Halloween show, which is Friday, October 30th, we're going to try and communicate with this doll and see if we can get anything. But in the meantime, Lucy had asked that I sort of update and keep everybody updated on things, which I haven't been able to this week. But yes, I can say that something has been a little bit different. If you do watch the video, you'll notice that I do mention something about burning of my hand, which happened the day that I had received the doll, but had not opened the package yet. And I badly burned my hand, which, Lucy, if you can see, it's still bandaged up. It's still bandaged up because it's burnt on my knuckles. And so I'm not able to bend my fingers or grab anything, because it hurts tremendously. And so I have it still bandaged up, which is really difficult to do while I'm working, because I work with my hands a lot. So that had happened the day that I received the doll at my house. The next day, or the day after, as I'm showing Lucy right now on Skype, I have another bandage on my other hand, on my thumb, because since I can't use my, because it happened on my right hand, the burn, I can't use my right hand. I was trying to get something out of a box, and it was a piece, it was a prop for this Halloween thing that we're doing at work, and I was pulling it out of the box, and it had a sharp edge to it, and as I was pulling it from the cord angle, I pulled it out of the box, grasping the box in between my knees. I pulled it out by the wire, and the box itself slammed, you know, rushed out of this box and hit my hand, and the corner edge dug a deep gash into my left thumb. So that was bleeding profusely, and so I had to bandage it up, and it was a huge chunk, another huge chunk that came out of my hand. So I've got now both hands that are injured, and if you look at that video of the doll that we did of the unboxing, you'll notice that she does have burn marks on her. Her hands are, there's one hand, if I remember correctly, is a little bit melted, but her arm is melted, and her face is burnt. And that's it physically, but I've been a little bit of a scatterbrain this week for some reason. Just, you know, I'm forgetting a lot. Things are just not falling into place as they usually do. It feels like, you know, I'm in Mercury retrograde, but I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it felt like this week for me. So I don't know. I don't know if that's paranormal, and I'm not claiming that that's paranormal, but that's just the incidents that happened this week since I've received the doll. Again, we're going to find out more about this doll on our Halloween show, which will have a live YouTube show on it, which you can check out more of the updates on our Facebook page. We'll start to promote that probably this week or later this week. So it'll give you the link to the YouTube channel. And we're going to try and communicate. We found a lot of different things to communicate with. There's the candle communication, pendulum, there's the regular EVPs, the spirit box, and there's a couple more things that I've actually found online that hopefully that I haven't shared with Lucy yet, but we're going to try and see if we can utilize during the sessions. And we're going to get feedback and actually include you guys who are going to be watching and listening an opportunity to call in and try and speak to the doll in my home. So we're going to give you guys an opportunity to do that as well. Not everybody, but, you know, if you're interested, you can always email us or shoot us a message, and we'll put you to the front of the line. But if you're calling in the night and you're the first to call in, we're going to pick up the line and have you guys talk to the doll as well and help us communicate.
Mm-hmm.
But that's it. So I don't want to expand more on that because we'll talk about that later. But tonight is celebrating, and tonight is talking about past guests. So what's the next update? Who else did we receive notes from?
Well, back in February, on the 27th of 2015, we did a show with Deanna Kelly Sayed about Muslim in the paranormal. And she sent us this wonderful update. She said, "Greetings. It is nice to hear from you, and congratulations on 4 years. That's a huge accomplishment." She does have an engagement this Friday evening, so she's just going to send us a little update. She has just completed a writing residency where she started on her memoir. And she has become a storyteller, like the kind on stage. She tells personal stories, including ghost hunting tales, along with folklore from the Muslim world. And in October, she opened at North Carolina's big storytelling event called the Monty. She told a story about a night that she spent in an abandoned asylum on a ghost hunt. The events that happened encouraged her to come home the next morning and finally leave what was an unhappy marriage. She says, "I hope all things are good with you guys, Deanna." So thank you, Deanna. I mean, that was really interesting to get that perspective with everything that happens in the news, you know, nowadays. It was interesting to see and to hear how the Muslim world looks at the paranormal. And she really is a brilliant storyteller. She really is a great writer. Her blog has a lot of insights into that world, a lot of things that I never knew. And, you know, it's not always the paranormal that we talk about. Sometimes we talk about religion, and sometimes we talk about other things. So to me, this was a true learning experience to see what a culture that I don't know anything about. I learned a lot from her, and I really do appreciate her coming on and sharing it with us.
Yes, you know, she has written a book on, you know, sort of paranormal in the media. I can't for the life of me remember the actual title, But it was about paranormal in the media, and she talked about the television shows and pop culture and all of that stuff. And I noticed on other radio shows and other shows out there on the internet that she was on, they basically talked about that. No one had touched the topic of Muslims and the paranormal. Not that it's a huge controversy. I certainly don't think that, but I don't think it's been discussed, and I don't think it's been talked about. And I know that people have certain mindsets about different religions and, you know, how they view the paranormal. You know, we all think because either we're Catholic or Jewish or Buddhist or, you know, whatever, what have you, that that is the way that the world views it as well. But it is the same, but there's many differences that are within the different religions as they view the paranormal. And it was interesting to talk to Deanna about Muslims and the idea of actually paranormal investigating as a Muslim, because that's typically not something that is you know, done in the homeland. It's actually frowned upon. And so, you know, just discussing that and her thoughts and theories, and then also talking about, you know, because she's Muslim, how did she fit in here being in America with what is the majority of Catholics that govern many of the paranormal groups out there? You know, how was her initiation into these groups or into these teams? Did they have any effect on her as an investigator? Did any of her theories and beliefs within the Muslim culture, did that have any impact on fellow investigators, or did it have an impact on the investigation itself? So that's what interested us. And we were surprised and shocked that, you know, nobody really touched that surface yet until we did. And so it was interesting to go that route and understand it, because, again, we always talk about things that could be linking a lot of the paranormal together. And, you know, even though religion has its doubts and there are these holes that many people cannot fill within the religious world, there is some truth to things. And whether or not we can, you know, understand them as themselves, as they're written in the holy books, or is it better to understand them when we experience the paranormal and try to connect those dots together? That's a mystery. That's a journey. And that's a show that we love to put on, and not just, like I said, be the cookie cutter type of operation.
Well, let's see. We've got another update. And this one, this show, I never really expected this one to be as interesting as it was. This was the show that we did back on May 29th, 2015. And it was with Dr. Shane Rogers. And it had to do with mold versus ghosts. Dr. Rogers had a theory. He has a theory that whether or not the mold and the conditions inside an old building could lead to people actually seeing ghosts. You know, does it have any connection? So Dr. Rogers sent us an update, and he says that they're well down there. They're down to excellent students due to graduation who are moving on to their professional career. And he's up to 3 motivated students this semester that are really just intellectually curious about this particular research question. It's been a busy summer and fall as he trains them and prepares for a 7-month sabbatical in Norway, perhaps a chance for some international gold, ghost or mold hunting. They're still investigating haunted locations, adding to the air quality database. They probably will be for a while before they can analyze their data and draw any conclusions. Another great sidelight that has come out of it, of their work, is the ability to provide folks with advice on how to address some of their moisture and mold issues. He's always surprised at the generous hospitality of those that allow us to invade their homes and businesses to scientifically investigate the potential causes of their hauntings, and even if they still have challenges at other locations allowing us access. He did mention that some places just didn't want to let them in, And he says that they're always looking for additional locations to sample, especially within driving range. So if anyone out there is interested, you can contact Dr. Rogers directly and maybe get some answers. You know, if you think that you have a haunting, is it possible that the mold or the conditions of the building or the area is causing that?
Yeah, and you can actually reach out to him. He is within the Potsdam, New York region. So if you are listening and you are within that area or close to that area, you can contact him and he can actually come out and check out your home or a location if you own a business or something like that. He will scientifically check out your home for mold spores and anything that's airborne that if you believe that there's paranormal, he can correlate those experiences with whether or not you do have mold spores or anything that's toxic in the air that could lead to the effects of paranormal. You can actually reach out to him at Clarkson University in Potsdam, New York. And I'll give his number. His number is 315-268-6501. He's an amazing guy, and his experiment that he's doing, which is going to be written up, I believe, it in a book that will encompass his findings, was really interesting to talk to him about why he did it and some of the paranormal experiences that he experienced while conducting these. So, you know, here's a skeptic, full-blooded skeptic, who's going into these locations trying to figure out things that on a scientific level, but also having paranormal experiences that he cannot explain. And he talked about the wrappings on the wall and on the desk, I remember. But there was one question that one of our intelligent listeners asked in chat to ask him during that night, and I remember this, I still remember this, about the person posed the question to say that mold spores are living organisms. So could these living organisms have some sort of soul or spirit attached to them that also creates the experiences of the paranormal? You know, we sort of think of mold or mildew as a thing, as an inanimate object, but it is a living organism. It's growing. You know, there is life to it. So do these spores, do these mildew and mold, do all of them, since they are living, have some sort of spirit attached to them that could be causing the same thing that we think of as a human being spirit for a paranormal experience? And it was one of the questions that I remember, not that he had a hard time answering it, but he said he couldn't answer it because that was still within the scope of his experimenting and could be something that's possible or something that's discussed on another level after he conducted his entire project. So that to me was an amazing question, and that came from our listeners and something to think about because, you know, after asking him that on behalf of the listener, I had never thought of that before, and it could be something that we should be exploring as well.
Well, yeah, I mean, consciousness. Does consciousness go? We always think of in terms of our own consciousness, but does consciousness actually, how far does it go? Does it go to small little things like fungus? I mean, do living particles have some sort of consciousness? That's a question. I mean, I just thought about that, and I never really thought about that before.
Well, you always made fun of me whenever I said that plants, you know, have feelings. And so it's actually been scientifically noted that plants have feelings. When you tear a leaf, there was this experiment that was done not too long ago that where they actually can get an audio piece of evidence from plants. When you tear a leaf, there's actually not a scream, but there's an audible sound that is heard coming from the plant, which in turn tells the scientist that there is a reaction to what you are doing as an effect to this plant. And if you are creating an effect, causing a reaction, there's got to be thought. There's got to be some sort of level of consciousness, some level of being within this plant. And so, obviously it's in its early stages of development, but I still think that plants are living things. And not that I'm saying that there's plant spirits or ghosts roaming the planet right now, but they are living things. And what does that mean to the paranormal? Is there anything that can be contributed to within the paranormal? Does it help facilitate the paranormal and spirits to interdimensionally travel to this area so that we as living human beings can correspond and communicate? I don't know. It's just, here's where we start to get into the ideas that just lead us into other different paths and channels that makes you think. And that's why we love to do these shows. It's just, it gives you a headache. I know that. But it's just, it's the only way that we're ever going to try and get any way closer to finding some sort of realistic answer to the thought of life after death.
Well, see, now I'm starting to feel really bad because of all the plants that I've killed in my lifetime.
I made a joke about a vegetarian. I said, well, you know, you're saying that, you know, they're killing animals for the sake of something edible, but you may be doing that to the plants as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's there is one more update that I really wanted to get to, and it comes from probably my favorite show of the past year. And this is one that I did, and I had to interview my co-host because he had written a book. I got to interview Anthony this year about his book that he wrote. And I'd like to get an update. How is the book selling? And you didn't know I was going to throw this one at you.
No, I didn't know you were going to do this to me. all right, so for putting me on the spot, I can tell you this. I have, honestly, it is my own fault. I haven't been truly marketing and promoting it, which, shame on me, I should be doing. But then again, that's not me. I hate to do those types of things anyway. But it did, you know, I think pretty well the first month and a half. So August 3rd was when it was published and released. And so up until mid-September is doing really well, and sort of now it's plateaued. But that's because I haven't really done anything with it or promoted it. But, you know, I've heard a lot of good feedback from folks, which I really do appreciate. So thank you all who went out to Amazon and picked up the book. Thank you so much. I'm going to do a little bit more promoting, maybe at the end of the year or the beginning of 2016 in January, and you know, maybe get it out there more a little bit, because not that I think that what I say is the truth, but I think a lot of the theories that are discussed in the book have been discussed on the show. I've just only sort of went a little bit deeper and, you know, sort of finished the puzzle. Not finished the puzzle, because nothing's finished, but tried to finish the puzzle a little bit to the things that I believe could be the truths that we should seek even further. So that's my update, basically.
Well, the name of the book is The Death of Me, and it's Consciousness, Spirits, and the Afterlife, and it is by Anthony Agati, and you can get it on Amazon. And I really, really did enjoy doing that show. I mean, it was cool, and I'm still so proud of you, and if you're not going to promote it, then I will, okay?
All right. Who else do we have? We don't have any more updates, right?
We don't have any more updates.
All right, so why don't we get to maybe a clip right now. Okay, let's go down the list. Does anybody remember, you know, we talk about this a lot, and we've talked about this a lot over the past 4 years, the Ouija board. You know, there's this huge debate and stigmata on the Ouija board itself. And, you know, I think media has to blame for it. I think it's a healthy debate to discuss it, but I'm a little disturbed by the fact of when people vehemently say that, you know, we cannot use it as a tool for communication when we're investigating, or that, you know, we're basically dancing with the devil when we do it. Because in my mind, there really is no difference between that and the audio digital recorder or any other tool, dowsing rods or pendulum, anything else that you utilize to communicate with is the same as a Ouija board. And I think it's just, you know, movies and Hollywood that's created this aura about it, that it's evil, that it is bad, that you should not be doing it. But I highly disagree, and I know Lucy disagrees with that as well. And, you know, many of you guys who are listening do believe, you know, within us as well. But there are not too many people that stand up for that. You know, we've had Robert Murch, who is, you know, one of the biggest, not debaters, but presenters and commentators about the Ouija board. And I think Robert Murch sort of lies in between. He's not for it and he's not against it. He just tells what's real about it, and he talks about the truth about it. But there's also somebody else that does stand by him as well, and that's Karen Dahlman. And we had Karen Dahlman on a while ago, and you know, to talk about the Ouija board, talk about her experiences. She's written many books about it and is continuing to write books about it to enlighten and educate people on the Ouija board, and that there is a good aspect to it. It's all a matter of your intention, and to understand it fully and not just believe what the media and pop culture has led you to believe. So here's a clip from our show that we did with Karen Dahlman that talks about the Ouija board and communicating with, I think, something that's a little bit different that people not normally have heard before or is not so much up for conversation, which is communication with aliens or interdimensional beings, which I found a little bit interesting. And I think we sort of preempted one of her projects because she talks about it being in her next book, which obviously then she doesn't talk much about. But it's interesting to hear what she talks about, what Karen talks about with communicating with aliens using the Ouija board. So take a listen to this.
Let's just say I've spoken to interdimensional beings, and they identify themselves sometimes by names or by locations. So I'd say yes. I haven't really come out publicly with that yet,
okay.
And that would probably be my Advanced Ouija 101 book. But yet, I'm launching a new website. You have it, KarenADahlman.com. And in that, I'm going to start sharing a lot of these sessions that I'm having and getting some more of these advanced topics, such as the higher self, interdimensional being, which is ETs, little going beyond some of the stuff we're talking about tonight. But no, that's a great question. I know people that I've worked with and are in communication right now with those types of beings via the board. And there's, of course, there's channels out there that many of you probably know who do this work too. They didn't necessarily use the board, but they speak to supposedly these kind of beings. So what I found, if your mind is open and you're living and working outside of the box or outside of the board, no pun intended, that you really can open up to and communicate with to many sentient conscious beings. It's really mind-blowing when you get going with this. You're only limited by your beliefs.
Well, you know, I don't believe the idea that we definitely know that we are speaking to aliens or who we're speaking to, and so I'm not sure that I understand how Karen can delineate the two or how anybody can delineate the two, but it's interesting to see how that concept arrives and how people actually are communicating and what is coming through, and that's all through the actual conversations that you're having. So it's an interesting area to get into. I'm not saying go out there right now, get a board, and start communicating with aliens. I'm saying think about it, understand what the Ouija board is, but maybe read about it, research about what it is that the Ouija board can do and what other people have experienced before getting into any of those areas.
Well, Ouija boards, like I said, I still think it's a tool. I don't feel the negative that people seem to associate with it. And I still want to study further on it, and I'm still willing to use it. So I'm very glad that we talked to Karen. And you know what? I did learn a lot from her, and hopefully our listeners did too.
Well, you know, one of our previous guests that we had on, which I see they're on the line right now, which we'll introduce to you. These are one of our surprise guests for tonight. I think was a really emotional show that we did, and
yeah.
Something that I think needed to be discussed and talked about. And it was on 9/11. We had Frank Mara and Maria Abate on talking about their book, From Landfill to Hallowed Ground. And, you know, it talked about Frank's experiences being a first responder there and working on the Staten Island a dump to landfill, you know, sift through a lot of these things. And he was basically in charge of the automobile and vehicular area, so the fire trucks and the vehicles that were left behind. From either the people that perished on 9/11 or just left their vehicles there because they were leaving the city. And so he talked about that experience in dealing with the families, but also he talked about an interesting area, which is in the book, From Landfill to Hallowed Ground, talking about this spirit interaction, this, I believe it was a Salvation Army worker or Red Cross worker, sorry,
Red Cross worker.
Spirit that many of the guys that were working in the landfill had seen and witnessed. And it was an interesting conversation that I thought that, you know, Lucy and I thought that we should share and talk about and understand a little bit better. And so I do want to welcome, I think we have on the line, Frank Mara and Maria Abate. Are you guys there with us?
We're here.
Yep, we're here. How are you?
Hi, how are you?
Good,
thanks
we're
for coming
really
on
well.
The show,
thanks
guys.
For back.
Yeah, thanks
well,
for
thanks
coming
back.
On. You know,
terrific.
When after that show that we did on 9/11, you know, it obviously was a little bit emotional for me being from New York, and I was you know down there during the time of the incident itself. A lot of the conversation that we had with you. Stirred up a lot of the memories for me afterwards. And it was the next day I remember on that Saturday after I woke up, I was still thinking about the interview that we did with you. And there were a lot of things that came back that I don't know if I just pushed away because on that day I was actually there at the World Trade Center when the first plane hit and then had to leave the island, leave Manhattan to go back into Brooklyn. There were things that I must have pushed away. And the next day after that interview, a lot of it came back. A lot of it flooded. And, you know, I never really had a full conversation with anybody about 9/11 like I did with you guys. And so, one, I want to thank you for that because that sort of opened it up for me. And reading your book opened it up more for me to actually, come to grips with it. But how has life been for the both of you guys after, you know, going on, you know, the gamut and I'm assuming a tour or something with this book and getting it out to the public? Have you seen a difference in yourselves, not just from, you know, the reactions of other people, but in yourselves of after completing this book and getting it out there and talking about it more often? Has anything changed for the both of you?
I think the change began for both of us when we began to write it, and the change just got stronger and stronger as the book was published and it came out back in March. You know, again, for me personally, just writing the book itself was therapy, and a lot of what you went through, Anthony, from our last conversation is things that I went through as I wrote that book, and how just thoughts and memories that you forget about or you just lock away came out as we pressed on with the book. So I completely understand all the emotions you had the next day, because that's a lot of what I went through during the process of writing the book.
I would have to agree. I think for Frank, it was very much therapy. For me, it was a huge learning experience. I think what we feel now and what we've taken from the book is we feel very strongly about pushing the education of 9/11. And I don't think that it's out there enough. I think it's still very sore for a lot of people, so it doesn't get spoken about as often as it should. And I think at this point, our new direction is educating people more, educating our children more about the events that took place and what happened thereafter.
Well, you know what? I do want to thank you guys, too, because reading that book, Anthony had taken me to Ground Zero, and I felt so much when I went there. And your book was really kind of confirmation of a lot of the feelings that I got from that location. So I do want to thank you for that. Being here in Chicago, we kind of like watched everything from the outside. And at the time, there was no way to truly feel what was going on, to actually live in the city, to be there, to experience it. So years later, when I went to the site, all of these emotions and all of this, there's definitely, to me, there are still spirits there. So your book definitely was confirmation of a lot of those things that I felt. And, yes, I do feel that it does have to be taught to our children, and we do need to remember. And I am so really strong in that resolve that, yes, we can't forget this. We really can't.
Right. I agree.
Absolutely. Just to add to what Maria said, I'll use the term statistic show. In this country, I believe the average junior in high school has no recollection of 9/11. And I think that's what makes it harder for teachers to actually try to teach about 9/11, because you're basically starting from scratch. So our new platform is we're trying to put together, like starting with the high schools into the colleges and universities, some form of a tour where we're going to try to go around and not basically do the basic book signing, but have it more like seminars where we could try to educate and answer questions relative to 9/11, which one, educates people, and two, keeps the day relevant, in which it should, and it doesn't go forgotten.
You know, I don't know if it was after our show that I learned of this or if it was before, and I can't remember if I brought it up to you guys, but I had remember seeing a video around that time, around 9/11, just last month, about some broadcaster or some journalist doing an interview at a college, and I think it was in Virginia, and they were asking the new incoming freshman what was the cause of 9/11, or what was the basis for 9/11, and no one could answer it. No one had an idea of why it happened.
Isn't that amazing?
It shocked the hell out of me. I'll be really frank with you. It shocked the hell out of me that nobody understood it or couldn't even fathom a reason for it. And some of the answers that they were given blew me away, that I don't even know how they understood that. Why do you think it's not discussed in schools? Why do you think it's not in the curriculum? It should be. It's 14 years already now. There should be some sort of at least a snippet in the history books by now to teach the kids that are in elementary school at least an understanding or just a basis for this happened on 9/11, 2001, and so on and so forth. Why do you think it's not out there yet?
From an education standpoint, I feel, and Frank has seen firsthand as well, it seems to be very controversial. Like, it seems to be a very sore subject for certain people, and I think that it's become a moment in history where some people still are for lack of a better term, I guess, offended by teaching it in the school so far. I think that some people feel that that's something that should be left to families to discuss with their children at their own discretion. You know, Frank and I have seen our kids go through school, and, you know, there's only so many times you can revisit the American Revolution over and over and over again. Right. I feel like they've never left it. You know, and there's no current history being taught in our schools enough at the elementary school level for them to really understand or appreciate their everyday existence and freedoms that they, you know, that they exhibit every day. And I think that 9/11 is so detrimental to their everyday existence and our current events and things that are still going on every day today as a result of the events that took place on that day. You know, and it's sad. It really is. And I understand maybe at the younger levels it might be something that's hard to deal with. In the New York City school system, you're dealing with a lot of families who are still so tied to 9/11, whose fathers and uncles and brothers were or husbands were first responders who lost their lives, or family members of people who lost their lives that day, so they're not ready to talk about it. But I think at the high school level, our children have reached the maturity level that they can understand it, that they can wrap their heads around it and see it for what it really was. I think people are afraid, you know, and even with the Red Cross worker in Frank's book, going back to that, you know, you get a very divided opinion about that particular chapter. It's something most people don't want to talk about. Some people don't want to tread, you know, waters of the paranormal or even think that that's even an option, but they'll agree to the fact that those grounds up at the landfill are sacred, as such as Ground Zero. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a lot of trepidation with people and anxiety about using 9/11 educationally. I don't know. That's just from my opinion.
Well said. I think it was well said.
Beautiful. How have you been? Have you been trying to go around to, I guess, propose the idea to high schools and universities and colleges? And have you gotten any responses back from any of the institutions?
No, nothing yet. But it is priority one. And it started about a month ago. And we're working with someone who knows someone like within Barnes and Noble who deals with colleges and universities, and then the person who we're dealing with also has a great background on dealing with local high schools and universities. So we're trying to leverage this person's knowledge to start that up, going to go forward, and we're hoping that it starts to pan out. With some signings at the universities and colleges. Everything up until now has always been, not that we are knocking it, but, we do Barnes & Noble signings. We actually have one coming up in November in another part of New Jersey. So we're trying to expand from the actual traditional signing to where it would be more like a seminar where you'd come for an hour and a half or 2 hours, and not only could you get a copy of the book, but you'd be educated in X, maybe questions that people have wanted to ask, have been afraid to ask, all this time for whatever reason. And again, to answer your question, and I firmly believe this, for a lot of people, the day's not old enough. It's only 15 years old, and, it's unfortunate. We live in a very sensitized society, and you just don't want to offend someone who might be sitting there whose relative was a victim on that day, and that's the impression that I get. And it's not like that in everywhere. We get people from all over the country, who will Facebook our pages, who are teachers as far as Dallas, Texas, who have great curriculum on that day and spend a whole week talking about it. So some people are doing it, but we don't think enough people are.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything that the public who are listening right now and who probably will be listening on our archive once the show is archived, is there anything that the public can do to help? You know, if it's not to join or to invite you guys, is there anything that you can think of that the public, maybe parents of the children or kids that are out there or people who do work in the school system, is there anything that anybody can do to try and get this encouraged more?
Well, if it's like you said, if they do want to encourage, I would think the best way is to go to your local Board of Education monthly meetings and speak about it and ask why, you know, why isn't part of a social studies or history curriculum? And they might say it is. Maybe they do one day or 2 days. You know, I don't know. But that's the most direct way for local communities to address it, I would think. Or they could, you know, they could reach out to us. They could reach out to our website, to our publisher. And if it's something that we can handle, we could actually come. And like I said, we could maybe do some sort of seminar at their college or university.
I also feel that most districts do listen. They pay very close attention to the parents and families. And I think that that's a driving force for most school districts. I think it's through families. Absolutely.
Well, I just want to say that, you know what, it is a part of our history. It really is. And it's something that I do want to thank both of you for working towards it and to keep it, you know, in our knowledge database. I mean, it's something that did happen to us, and I really feel personally that we can't forget about it.
No, I agree. I agree wholeheartedly with you. And, you know, I just hope that people will act and, you know, and continue to educate and continue to talk to your children about it, especially as the anniversary comes around.
Well, the book is called From Landfill to Hallowed Ground, The Largest Crime Scene in America, authored by Frank Mara and Maria Bate. We do want to thank you both for coming on the show and giving us an update. Where can everybody who's listening right now, where can they go to learn more about the book or learn more about you guys or contact you guys maybe even?
They can contact us on our website. It's from landfilltohallowedground.com. You know, they could actually fill out, there's a form that they could fill out and we can respond to them, or they could email us at fromlandfilltohallowedground@gmail.com, and we, of course, will respond. And, of course, the book can always be purchased at your local Barnes & Nobles or right online at Amazon, at amazon.com.
You mentioned you were going to be in New Jersey coming up soon. Where in New Jersey are you going to be for that signing?
At Hamilton, New Jersey, at the Hamilton Barnes & Nobles on Route 130. I don't have the exact address.
Yes, okay. And it's November 21st.
Yes, November 21st from 1 to 3. And it's part of a book fair.
Okay.
So some of the proceeds will be going back to a fund that we've picked as part of the book fair relevant to 9/11. It's a 9/11, I forget the exact name of the fund. Do you remember it?
It funds for the education of 9/11.
Right.
Great, because, you know, I think I have family who lives in that area, so I may come down there.
Oh, great.
Oh, that would be fantastic. That would be great. We said it's the 21st of November from 1 to 3 at the Hamilton, New Jersey Barnes & Nobles. It's a beautiful area right there, too.
Yeah.
A really nice area.
Yeah, it is. So, again, thank you guys so much. The book, again, is called From Landfill to Hallowed Ground, The Largest Crime Scene in America. Frank, Maria, thank you so much for coming on tonight and giving us an update. We wish you both the best of luck, and hopefully we'll have you guys back on the show again soon.
That would
be
great.
Thank you so much for having us again, really. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Take care.
Good night.
Bye.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
It's an amazing book, an amazing read, and you know, I didn't get into, obviously, you know, we had an interview with him. We talked about the Red Cross woman, that spirit woman that Frank saw and that many of his friends at the landfill saw as well. That was an amazing story visually to try and picture that. So if you really are interested, it's a great read. It talks about, there's actually some controversial chapter in there talking about how there were no street vendors and downtown New York that morning, which was very odd and very strange. We talked about it on the interview the last time when they were on 9/11, and if you read the chapter, it'll start to make you think. I don't think it's a, you know, conspiracy theory, but it's something that's been noted by a lot of people, and I don't know what that means, you know, these street vendors not being there. I don't know what it is. But it's an interesting chapter that they wrote about. You know, they talked about not only what they did, but there are a lot of little things in there that they've added in that really make this book really interesting. You know, it's, you know, educational, but it's also a fun read and something that's, I know, dear to their hearts, and I know which will be dear to your hearts if you read. So check it out. I really do highly recommend the book, From Landfill to Hallowed Ground, The Largest Crime Scene in America. Yeah, they're great. They're great people.
It's a really good book. And if, you know, just to read it, it does gives you so much to think about. And honestly, I did find the story about the Red Cross worker comforting. I mean, it's just something in the middle of all this horror that, in a way, yeah, to me, it definitely seems paranormal. But it was also comforting. You know, I liked it. So it is a great book. You got to pick it up and you got to read it.
They talked about the Red Cross being a guide to the spirits to move on. You know, at first thought, they were thinking that maybe this spirit woman from the Red Cross was there to help them, the workers at the landfill.
Mm-hmm.
But as they were thinking about it more, they started to realize maybe they were there to help the spirits who were trapped within, you know, this dimension, or even within the rubble and the confines of the rubble, to you know, if you're lost, to grab their hand and move them forward. And that's what they were thinking of. And that's where they were hoping, if anything. They were hoping that that's what this was all about. So, again, it's a great book. I highly recommend it. We have 28 minutes left. Wow. Flying by. So I don't know if we're going to get to all of the clips. Who do you want to get to next? You pick, Lucy. What clip do you want to go to next?
Let's go to Nick.
Which Nick?
Nick Groff.
Okay. I knew you were going to go to Nick.
Only because I work so hard to get Nick onto the show. And we're talking about Nick Groff, who everyone knows was a member of the Ghost Adventures crew. He has been, you know, I have always admired him from the first time that we've met him. We've been lucky enough to investigate with both him and the other members of the team. And Nick is on his own journey now, and he's working with a lot of he's got the Nick Groff tour where they go to different haunted locations, and we were able to spend an evening with him and talk to him, and of course the question came up, why Nick left Ghost Adventures and what motivated him to make a change, and he kind of gave us an answer.
No, he gave us an answer, and I read a lot from that answer. I'm not going to impose my thoughts on his answer, which you're going to listen to right now. I implore you to listen with a clean and open ear, and you know, sort of listen in between the words, if you know what I mean. He really does tell the truth, I think, and you'll understand why after listening to this clip. So take a listen. We asked Nick, or Lucy had, if I remember correctly, Lucy had asked him why he had left Ghost Adventures to go on to do a sort of, you know, his operations with his own show and become a producer and director on his own. So take a listen to this.
Sure, yeah. No, I get it. I get the question every single day since it's been announced. It's totally fine. I think, you know what, I'm a positive person, and I'll leave it at that. And I think there's just certain things in life that you have to step forward, and you find stepping stones. And obviously it's through hard and good times or whatever it is where you came from, you just have to look at that from outside the box and think about certain things that you want to do in life. And, you know, it's just kind of one of those moments in my kind of threshold where I have to cross over and just say there's certain things that I want to get to that I want to actually kind of go after and, you know, more interesting topics and stuff like that that I want to conquer and whatnot. So it's just one of those things where I'm at my part where I have a lot of things that I want to go after as far as paranormal goes and learn a lot more. So I'm just in that moment of doing that in my life. So it's very positive. I mean, I'm happy. I'm extremely happy right now, and I'm really focused. And it's probably the best move for me personally right now. And I'm working on probably more things than I was working on when I was there. So it's absolutely awesome. It has to do with the love of paranormal investigating that I'm doing right now. And just, like, I feel like I'm rooted. You know, like that first part, like when I was doing the documentary back in the days, and it was just, you know, me and other guys out there, and we're just doing it. Like, that's what I feel like. It's that rush of, you know, here I am in a haunted location, I'm trying to investigate and communicate with spirits or try to understand what else is out there, you know, by maturing through the years and understanding where I came from to where I am now. And now I'm in that focus point of, wow, I want to go even deeper. I want to get a little bit more involved or learn new things or try different things. You know, it's the evolution of just understanding yourself and understand what you can experiment with and connect with as an individual into the paranormal world. So that's kind of where I'm at in my life right now. And, you know, obviously there's so much more to it, but to sum it up in a positive manner, that's, you know, that's my life to speak on that topic.
And there you have Nick's answer.
You know what?
Got it.
What I take from that, I mean, honestly, meeting Nick, investigating with him, talking with him, I really like him. I mean, I really feel that he does have that thirst for answers. And I think he's doing it. I think maybe not being bogged down in kind of like the way certain people tend to dramatize, you know, what they're doing. I think he really, really is intent on finding the answers, not so much the, and I hate to say it again, the drama around it, you know, the sensationalism around it, but to actually find answers. And he had recently just announced that he will be coming back to television, that he's going to be producing a paranormal television show, which I'm absolutely looking forward to. I would like to see what he is coming up with.
Yeah, I'm not going to comment because I do have my own theories on that. But, you know, it's sort of the same lines. I think he's a true advocate for the paranormal and searching for the truth. And I think he is back to where he was when he first started in this, when he first did that documentary. I think those feelings are now coming back to him, and he's loving it. And he's energized, and he has that passion for it again. And I think doing these different shows, he has the ability to control, you know, the way that it should be done. And people may still disagree with you know, his current show, but I think he is on the right path. I think he is an awesome and educated producer. I think he knows right and wrong, And I wish him the best of luck, and hopefully, you know, we'll have him back on again. I know when Lucy was trying to get him on the show, it wasn't that, you know, he didn't want to do it. It was just that his schedule just kept flipping and changing, and, you know, when we were talking to him, he did apologize many, many times, and, you know, just couldn't find the right time to do it. And obviously, we do a live show every Friday night. It's not like, you know, we can, you know, pre-record anything. So it was trying to fit our time schedule, and he was gracious enough to do that. So we thank him for coming on and educating us and our listeners on what his thoughts were on the paranormal. So, you know, you can always go into our archives and listen to the entire show on any topic that we've had. We've got 203 shows that you can go through. So if you've got a boring Saturday or boring Sunday, go to our archives and take a listen to it. The clip that I want to play, which one do you think, Lucy, is the one that I want to play?
Not creationism.
Yes. Okay, so everybody,
know that one?
Everybody knows that, you know, Lucy and I tend to agree on a lot of things, mostly mostly every topic of every show that we've done, we've agreed on all the points. There may have been some things here and there, but I think for the most part, Lucy and I, you know, are in one brain, in one head, except when it comes to religion. And, you know, we've talked about that privately, you know, when we do investigations and, you know, when we talk about the paranormal off the air. There are things that I'll bring up, and there are things that Lucy will talk about and bring up, and that have to do with religion that, you know, I don't condemn her for anything. I don't, you know, stifle her at all. She does what she does, and I do what I do, but that's what makes us great. And I think you need that to be in a healthy, you know, paranormal relationship, if that's, you know, what you call it. But I think you need that because that difference can help you only grow stronger. And so we decided, there was one time in early summer of this year, in May, to create a show based upon religion. And the idea was Lucy would be about creationism, and I would be on the belief of evolution and have a healthy debate about it. So we discussed it, and we got into heavy conversations. I wouldn't say combative, but I'd say, you know, a healthy debate. I'll leave it at that. It was a healthy debate. So here's a clip from the show. This is just one of the many funny, good pieces of evidence of how Lucy and I would sort of operate, maybe even off the air. This will give you an insight of how we would talk to each other. So here's a clip from May 1st on creationism versus evolution.
And I said, I can't be a creationist for the general definition, because I don't really hold the Bible as the know-all, tell-all, okay? I do understand that it's been changed. But yet there's this thing, how is it that I can still believe in a divine being? Why is it that I can still look every morning and I get up and there's the sun and the sky and the air and the earth that I walk on? And to me, that's a miracle. That's not something that we put together in a lab. This is something that's here. I mean, who created that? Not us. Where
right,
did it come
not
from?
Us. No, we didn't create that. But I think I'm only alluding to the Bible because it's just one reference. You know, when I say the Bible, I pretty much I'm talking about all religions and faiths and beliefs in that manner. The idea that some supreme being created this, whatever it is not fact. I understand feelings and I understand, you know, all of that stuff, but you can't say to me that God created it. Because whatever the God is, you can't say to me that God created it because you have no evidence. You have no backup. Feelings, intuitions, all of that is not factual. It's not evidence and cannot be provided as such. What I'm going on and what I'm saying is I don't know if there is a God or not. There could very well be. But what I believe in is, in order for me to understand and to know for sure and to be confident in when I speak to someone about what I believe in, I pretty well damn sure will have, not evidence, but I will have backup to substantiate it. And so if I don't understand anything about this God, I can't say that God created the earth, the universe, the humans, the animals. I can say for sure right now that science is leading a way in determining how this happened. Now, we both talked about, mentioned Big Bang Theory. I'm not sure about that. There was also a theory that I heard, and I mentioned it tonight, that who knows if the actual universe has been imploding and expanding. It's sort of like an infinity loop. And so what was before the Big Bang could have been a implosion of the current universe, or of the universe that they had at that time, all coming together and smashing together and exploding out then and expanding, creating what we are theorizing today as the Big Bang. There.
I'm still not convinced. And this conversation will go on.
It will go on. We still have a debate about it. And, you know, the funny thing, not the funny thing is, but the insight to this all is that's the mentality that Lucy and I bring when we go into paranormal investigating. And I'm sure you guys notice that and feel that as well by just listening to us. But those are the kinds of theories and views that we hold when we investigate. And you can see the differences a lot of times on the experiences that Lucy has versus what I have. There's things that are unexplainable that I say, well, you know, is that in relation to God, or, you know, is there some evidence within the Bible that is the exact of what we just experienced? I still question it. It's not that I don't, it's not that I say God does not exist, that there is no such thing. I just say I don't know if there is, because I don't see anything that is leading me in the direction that God is there. I don't rely on the feelings that I have, because I can't bring that up if I ever had to be in front of a judge. I can't bring that up as being evidence in my opinion, in my world, and how I view things. That's just me.
And I know that, and I appreciate that. But for me, it still revolves around faith. It's just something that I have within me that I can't explain. And I know where you're coming from. You know, there's no evidence to prove it. I don't have anything to document it. But until I can see otherwise, until something really does prove to me that it's not there, it's not so much that maybe it is God is there, I haven't seen the proof that God is not. So, yeah, this conversation will keep going, and the disagreement will still be there. But I think, like, the way we investigate, yeah, our experiences are different. Sometimes we do have the same kinds of experiences, but they are different. And I think that's what makes it interesting for us, for in our search for answers, seeing how things affect you and the way they affect me kind of brings a more rounded answer. Not so much, well, not really answer, a more rounded experience. I can't just take everything that I feel and say, this is it. You know, because I have to take into account what you're thinking and what you're experiencing, because why is it you have your kinds of experiences? Why is it I have mine? You know, so, you know, see, thinking about this, now I want to go investigate, you know. But I do.
There's always that argument that I hear from atheists that say, well, you know, how can you believe in the paranormal then if you don't believe in, you know, a God or a,
right.
You know, a higher power? But I disagree with that because I don't believe that there's a need for a god or of some sort of religion to what I believe to be as your consciousness is what is your soul, is what is your spirit. And so there's no need for that god to be there. This world has been created, which, you know, either by the hand of some, you know, all-knowing and, you know, here's a question that nobody can seem to answer.
Okay.
Who created God? And I'm going to leave it at that. I'm not going to have you answer that, Lucy. I'm going to have people probably debate it on their own. But here's a question that I want to ask is, who created God then? How did God come into being? And I've heard so many answers to that effect. It's non-believable, in my opinion, on the actual real answers that have been given to me, mainly from the Catholic Church. So I that's the biggest question that I think needs to be answered, and it has not for me. And I think that's where that line is drawn. So I'm going to leave it at that. Let's just leave it at that, because
okay.
You know,
we'll
be on for another few more hours. But the last clip that I want to get to, we have a couple more, but we can only fit about one more in here. The last clip that I do want to get to is EA Coetting, which was a sort of controversial topic and show that we had, not because of a debate that we had with the guests at all. We loved EA Coetting. The debate is, or the controversy is, of people in the public who view him. And he is one who, if you're not familiar with him, he does he delves in black magic, and he lives his life within the black magic realm, and has done rituals and has spoken to many what he claims to be as you know, the demons, and can summon them up himself as well, and has done rituals and blessings for them. So that's what I mean by controversial. But one of the you know, the things that we've come into contact with over the years of talking on radio, and when you talk about Wiccan and witches and that sort of side of things, the pentagram comes up a lot. And again, just like the Ouija, there is this aura surrounding the pentagram that people are not truly understanding, that, you know, education needs to follow. And so we asked EA Coetting, you know, what is the true meaning of the pentagram? And here's his answer, which is pretty interesting. And I'd love for people to this is the reason why I wanted to bring up this clip, was I really think it needs to be said, and I think people should at least hear it, if anything, and then they can debate it afterwards. But here's what EA Coetting says.
Oh, wow, yeah, the pentagram is it's not the oldest, but it is one of the oldest symbols for spirituality and for a unification of the physical with the spiritual. You see, once again, there's this misunderstanding that our spiritual bodies are at war with our physical bodies. Complete misunderstanding. Our spiritual bodies are expressing and experiencing themselves through our spiritual reality. And so the pentagram, it does represent the four elements, fire, water, earth, and air. These are the four alchemical elements united with spirit. That these are all acting in accord. Now, whether or not the symbol is inverted or upright is really irrelevant, except for the fact that triggers something in the consciousness that has learned to associate it with certain things. Now, the reason that I use it so strongly is because I do promote black magic, in that we need to be free. We need to be free from all dogma, all externally imposed dogma. And so I use that because it's definitely been linked in our psyche with the darker, the forbidden. And I will say that these things of magic and witchcraft that we're discussing tonight are absolutely forbidden by our common priestcraft of our time. That the things that we're talking about are the individual becoming their own god and uniting and communicating with their universe, their reality, on a way in a way that completely obliterates the necessity of religion. That's forbidden. That is absolutely forbidden in our time. And so that I use the symbol of the inverted pentagram just to kind of signal and to trigger that Luciferian concept of self-enlightenment rather than enlightenment from an external source. But it does absolutely symbolize the union of the spiritual with the physical rather than the separation of the two.
You know, and that's as simplest as you can explain what a pentagram is. And I don't think that message has been brought to many of the ears of people who either are within the paranormal or not in the paranormal. You know, that the idea that this is not some satanic blood, you know, baby killing ritual, and that's the reason why you wear this or have this symbol around. It is just what he says. It's the unification of the physical and the spiritual, and you know, the connection between the two. It is one of the oldest symbols in the world, and so it has gone through the gamut of being or having this this mystery surrounding it all the time, and this negativity that is being connotated to it, that needs to be lifted, and it needs to be removed and understood a little bit better. You know, it sort of goes along with the conversation that we had with Corvus Nocturnum about the Church of Satan. You know, again, many people think that they get together and they kill babies and drink blood. That is not the case. It is self-enlightenment. It is growing yourself. And, you know, they may use the term becoming your own God, but that's because your interpretation of what God means is in misdirect correlation to what, you know, what Luciferian mysteries are all about. And so the idea of awakening yourself and building yourself and strengthening yourself is something that is good. It is something that we all should have. And, you know, it's not that it is in contrast to religion, but religion doesn't allow you to do that for yourself. You are not supposed to do that. You are supposed to give that strength to God and give that strength to your God. So, you know, I loved that we had E.A. Coetting on the show, and having that healthy discussion, and hopefully opening up some folks' eyes to the realistic views that many have been misinterpreted over the years.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I guess you can classify what he does under occult, and what is the meaning of occult? It's hidden knowledge. And because of the walls and barriers that we've put up by, you know, mainstream religion, we tend not to look at the other things that are out there, the other ways of looking at things. So, yeah, I will admit that I was really kind of taken aback by the whole title, you know, Become a Living God. But after speaking with him, a lot of things became clearer to me, and I really was okay with it.
All right, guys. So we've got about 3 minutes left of the show. We've been talking our heads off, and I apologize. But it is our fourth anniversary, so thank you all for joining us tonight. We want to thank you again. You guys are the ones that make this show, not just because we wouldn't be here without you guys, but you guys encourage us. You give us the strength. You give us the ideas and the theories and the topics to talk about. You guys are our guest every single Friday night. So thank you all. Lucy, what do you want to say? And then just get to the show ending.
Okay. I do want to take the time to thank you, okay, my co-host and my paranormal partner. You've put up with me for the past 4 years, and you have made this so much fun. And I really have learned so much from you, and I do treasure every Friday night that we do the show. I can't wait to see where the search leads us next. You're awesome, and I'm so lucky you're in my life. Thank you. So, let's talk about things to come. We think it's time for another infamous ITC session. This time, we thought that we would try to make a connection that might be a little bit controversial, but that's never stopped us before. Father Walter Halloran was a Catholic priest of the Society of Jesus, who at the age of 26 assisted in the exorcism of Roland Doe, a 13-year-old Lutheran boy in Cottage City, Maryland, who was allegedly possessed. Now, this case inspired William Peter Blatty to write his novel, The Exorcist. Now, will we be able to contact Father Halloran? Will he have any answers for us as to what really happened during Ronald's exorcism? This is going to be an extreme night for Paranormal Review Radio, so join us next week, if you dare. So, peeps, until next week, keep on shining like the stars you are. Thank you so much for listening to us. Thank you for being fans. Thank you for everything. Keep on shining and have a paranormal week. Good night.
Good night, everybody.
Paranormal Review Radio.
They said that you were wasting your time. They said it would never get you anywhere. But this holiday season, your selfie obsession might win you $25,000. That's right. All you have to do is go to a participating Cricut Wireless location, smile, snap a selfie with the Cricut character poster, and post it on Instagram or Twitter using the STSA hashtag shown on the poster. That's STSA, as in something to smile about. Come on, you know that nobody is more ready to win this than you are. You already spend your days taking kissy face selfies and gym selfies, and here I am eating pepperoni pizza selfies. Now show us your Cricut selfie. Plus, by entering, you'll also have a chance to win cool weekly prizes, like a Cricut Alcatel phone with 3-month service and a $100 gift card. So smile, snap a photo, and you could win $25,000. Have the best holiday selfie ever. Cricut Wireless, the merrier carrier. Something to smile about. No purchase necessary. Sweepstakes valid at participating Cricut stores only. For official rules and a list of participating locations, see stsasweepstakes.com.